The purpose of this podcast is to talk about buying a dental practice. And I think the first thing to say is, you know, be sure of your motivation for buying. Make sure you're focused and do your homework. This is the watchword. So, an overview for any buyer to know. Well, first of all, in the background, there's of course an increasing corporate demand and private equity funding out there. Increasing private practices values are going up, and there's that strong demand for practices. NHS remains as strong as ever. Of course, they're dependent on performance and their location. Orthodontic values as well, you may be surprised to hear, are increasing as contracts are secured. And there's still a considerable disparity in values. A geography, very much a quality driven, and of course the recruitment issues around where they are placed in the UK. These are all leading factors into the demand. Obviously, there's various different types of businesses, and there's sole traders, there's limited companies, there's asset versus share purchases. So make sure you get your accountant to explain to you what this exactly means and what the likely ongoing cost is going to be to you to have a limited company and the benefits for you. Partnerships. You could be buying into an existing one, or you could be forming a partnership, maybe with a friend. Do make sure you get legal help to ensure you're fully aware of any liabilities, and that's my watchword today. Practice profiles, as you know, there are various types. But do you know what you want? Are you sure about what you're getting into? There's NHS, there's mixed, there's fully private practices, and of course there are practices that derive income from plan income. And of course, what's in a valuation? You need to understand the proper valuation of a business you're about to buy. So let's talk about due diligence, the dreaded DD. There's many factors you need to become aware of while you're searching. Now remember, no two practices are the same, and so by default, every set of accounts you'll see will not only have a completely different layout with a potentially different reporting style of the costs, but the key skill here is for you to fully understand not only the accounts, but also any other contributory factors that make up that practice's particular profile. And most importantly, how the banks will ultimately value the goodwill. So let's talk through what you need to be fully aware of, or get clarity on, get some help if you're unsure, or most importantly, if you haven't been told. Now, your finance broker should help you identify many factors to help you get the funding. But sadly, that's not always the case. Or they're so keen to get the funding approved and earn their commission that many factors are overlooked. So what are you going to be looking at? As professional valuers, we need this kind of clarity around the accounts when we do the original valuation. We have to bottom out the true costs. But these are key items for you to get to understand better. Never be afraid to ask for help. You've got to think about local competition. You've got to look at the practice services that they offer. What about the income type? Is it one-off incomes? Is it regular, which you will get, of course, with NHS and you will get with plan income? And also think about the spread of fee generators. Is it all about the principal? And is he or she staying on? Because obviously you're buying the goodwill for a practice whereby they may still come back, but they may well not return once their favourite dentist has gone. Now, obviously, there's risk with any practice that you buy with this. Absolutely. But you just need to be sure that can you step into the shoes of the main fee earner if they are grossing most of the money? And certainly your bank will be looking at this as well. Is there scope for expansion? The banks will want to know about all of this. And we're not just talking about the financial expansion, new services, extra hours, etc., but also perhaps room to grow the business physically with an extension, perhaps out the back, put in extra surgeries. So do your homework and get your vision goggles on. Is it already maxed out space-wise? You know, we talk about an extension, but is there room there to bring in more services and, of course, more revenue? Other costs to bear in mind are there may be some refurbishments, there may be some huge costs to the fabric of the building. And have you thought of any equipment and surveys that are going to be required? There's going to be always considerable setup costs at the beginning of any purchase. But be careful that you don't buy a practice and then get burdened with huge costs. So make sure that you and your solicitor bottom out all this kind of thing. Of course, there is also clinical neglect to discuss. And also, you may be looking at investment for branding. Investment to make it yours. It could start with very simple, the signage, but the website and the investment that all that is involved to make it yours and to take it forward to the next stage. NHS performance is obviously key to look at. Make sure that everything is as it should be. And also check out the reviews online for the practices that you're looking at. See what you think of that. You can obviously change it once it's yours. But mystery shopping is something that some people do. And I think it's a great idea to get a flavour of the attitude when you phone in, when you call in of the front desk. Remember, first impressions are always critical. So let's talk about the perfect buyer. That's you. An agent's perspective. We need good buyers. We need lots of information. So do let your guard down. Talk to us and tell us what it is you're looking for. Of course, be prepared. Get your funding ready. Get your deposit ready. And I'll touch upon this when I do my webinar around why you use a dental broker. So get your ducks in a row, in other words. Get your solicitor, your accountant, make sure they're dental specialists. Get them round you and be ready. Don't wait until you see the practice of your dreams, the one that you really want to buy and you don't want to get left out on, and then spend a fortnight phoning around trying to get the support. Because trust me, the people, the credible buyers will have all this ready. And you're not wasting people's time by getting a solicitor ready on standby and ditto an accountant. We often are asked for recommendations, and of course we can help with this. Be realistic in your search as well. You know, don't become a bit of a time waster and ask for details of every single practice when you really aren't looking at them at all. By all means, do your homework, do your reconnaissance. It's a great thing to do. It's time never wasted. But don't become a time waster and start booking viewings for practices that you have no intention of going to see, because obviously that won't do you many favours with your agents. Communication and feedback is also very important. When your agent, when your broker talks to you about a viewing, please always communicate back. Make sure they know you've got that viewing, you will be attending there. And in the event that you can't make it, make sure that you let the principal and the broker know. But of course, a lot of these are after hours. So the onus is on you to make sure that the principal who's waiting for you at a practice is not just standing there half the night or on a Saturday on a day off. So communication is critical. Feedback is very, very good indeed for your broker. Immediately you've viewed a practice, make sure that you respond, you tell them what you think. And if you think you want to make an offer, tell them immediately. They can then feed that back to the principal. And we know that you're under the ropes and you're getting in the ring. So open communication at all times throughout the sale is what we need to help us know what's on your mind. And of course, we also need regular updates on your circumstances. For example, you may have decided to go and look somewhere other than when you first indicated when you registered online. So if you're suddenly thinking of Cornwall, Devon, Scotland, tell your broker and update us on your circumstances, not only on areas of search, but perhaps if you're moving your budget upwards and you're going into business with somebody. Now, remember, of course, that clinching the deal is the critical one. No practice is ever going to be perfect for you. You have to be realistic and you have to be flexible, because you're never going to get the 10 out of 10 points that you're looking for. And you may well find that you buy a practice that is not the profile that you first set out on, but it's ultimately the right practice for you, especially at the beginning of your journey when you're first buying a practice. So you have to be realistic. And I think if you get the advice from your financial broker to make sure the numbers work, you do your homework, you look around in the area, I think that you will find that you should make the right decision. And you can always get that dream practice 3, 5, 10 years down the line. Once you've seen the practice you like, be decisive. Remember that old saying, you snooze, you lose. Be confident and be poised and have the right team around you, getting your finance ready on standby. Get your proof of funding to show the broker that you're a credible, serious buyer. You then need to follow up with a swift written offer. Phone calls are nice, but we have to get it in writing. Emailing your broker, outlining the exact terms of your offer. Anything else, any other caveats that are very important to you, top of mind, you need to get these out there at the get-go. No point in holding shy and then coming out with it 3 months down the line. And get that offer over to your broker so they can relay that, and you then stand a fighting chance of securing that practice. Planning is everything. I really can't stress that enough. And of course, you've got to be ready as well to offer an immediate 1% deposit. That shows willingness to commit to the deal. You're showing skin in the game, and get your solicitor on standby, ready to hear from the other side solicitor. So in summary, getting your funding and a dental specialist solicitor and accountant on standby are the final vital pieces of the jigsaw. And while I'm on the subject of solicitors, please can I stress that don't go for your local low-cost or family member, old mate route. This is a false economy, and I can prove historically that deals that go along this route usually fail. A lack of experience in the dental arena causes delays, transaction fatigue and ill will sets up, and a lack of confidence in the buyer's ability to get the deal over the line because their solicitor may well be out of their depth and they're slowing the deal down, and it usually ends up in disaster. So please get a dental specialist solicitor. We can help with recommendations. We have a panel list, but get someone that's either NASDAQ recommended, that you know of and know that can protect you. The other thing to think about, of course, is business coaching. Investing in yourself is very important. And one of the key things about going to the bank for lending, especially as a first-time buyer, is showing the bank that they can have confidence in you because you have confidence and you've invested in yourself. You may be the best dentist in the world. You may be, you know, super skilled, but do you know how to run a business? It's a very different beast than just going to work and earning lots of money for somebody else. So invest in yourself, business coaching, some mentoring, learning about the financials, cash flow. These are very critical skills because even if you ultimately don't plan to do it yourself, you still need to understand how it works and what needs to happen to make a successful business profitable going forward. After all, you don't want to just go out there and buy yourself a job, do you? So take that leap of faith, seize that light bulb moment. Everybody has one. I've had one. It's never too late. Don't ever feel that it's too late for you to become your own boss and take charge of your own destiny. But please do your homework first. Don't go into it blind and ask for advice. A very good friend of mine once told my daughter on her graduation day in the speech that we all had afterwards, the party, he told her, he said, never be afraid of failure. And I thought that was a remarkably humble thing to say, because not being afraid of failure is good. It shows that you are going out there, you're trying. You're not going to get everything right, but take advice, do your homework. Don't go into it stubbornly thinking you know everything that's going to happen, because unfortunately in life you won't. Now, our goal as brokers is helping our clients, getting them over that winning line. So obviously, don't ever hesitate to reach out to us as well to help. So talking about deposits, obviously when you're accessing the market, I would generally say that the lenders are going to be looking at loaning 80% of the goodwill value. The loan to value available on the market is always subject to the individual person and of course the individual practice, because the specific practices have different EBITDAs. So it's not a rule of thumb across the board. But I believe the right acquisition with a strong funding application, you could even achieve a loan to value of up to 90% of the purchase price. So some top tips for you here. Experience. I would say you have to have 4 years experience as an associate. Lenders also want to see some kind of managerial experience on your CV. I talked about some business coaching. This is something that can tie in with this as you're getting ready. Practice ownership, of course, is a lot different to being an associate, and the banks are risk averse. So some kind of managerial experience is good. If you don't have that yourself, get somebody with you that you can demonstrate has that business financial acumen to support you. Business plans. The lenders, of course, want to understand your future plans and changes. For example, does it have that space to implement? We touched upon this earlier, but the banks are keen to know this. And also, are you going to be bringing in any new services, any new specialisms that will raise revenue? This is the kind of thing that you're going to be needing to work with your funder, your funding, your broker, to go to the banks. Additional fees. Make sure that you have the money set aside for any additional fees available to cover various different transactional costs. It's important that you have this money ready. There's going to be legal fees, of course, for you, and also bank legal fees. There's going to be valuation fees, security fees, and arrangement fees. I would often advise you secure or you sideline an extra £15,000 to £20,000, because that way you won't get caught out and the deal will not be faltered. And let's face it, the last thing you want when you're going through a practice sale, it's difficult enough, is to not have the cash readily available to pay the fees owed. Now, asset liability profile is something else to touch upon. The lenders will always want you to complete an asset liability spreadsheet. This allows them to understand fully your monthly earnings, your commitments, any discretionary, non-discretionary spending, and your monthly income surplus. Now, you may not have any at the moment, so this is the time now to start thinking about living perhaps better within your means and having more available cash. Because the lenders are going to want to get a very clear picture of your net worth, and also, do you own any properties? What's your net worth after all of that? So lastly, your liabilities. They want to know how much debt you have on credit cards, loans or mortgages. Mortgages are fine, of course, but the banks are going to be hesitant to lend to you if you have hefty credit cards outstanding with balances. So these are all things to keep in mind. Thank you very much for listening, and we look forward to potentially maybe helping you achieve and exceed your business ambitions one day. Thank you.